Last week, and not last, last time we talked about the socialism with Chinese characteristics. That I will continue next week. I'm now injecting a little side strip into it, is talking about the Chinese political system. And then we will look at how the current political system produce the political ideology today. So, Chinese political system. Now, Chinese political system is very different from what we understand as our political system. Okay, so I'm not going to judge whether Chinese system is better or worse than our political system. I'm just describing the difference. So there's no value judgment, although it might sound there is, but that's not my idea. Idea is to try to describe the difference. If we want to talk about the Chinese government system or political system, we cannot escape talking about the Chinese Communist Party, because they are so intertwined together. You just cannot separate them out. So it's better to describe the Chinese Communist Party and then look at how this party rule China. I need to make it a little bit smaller so that I can see the whole page. Yes. Okay. The Chinese Communist Party is the founding and the ruling political party of today's People's Republic of China. And it is the only governing party of China. No other party can govern China except Chinese Communist Party. That is written into the Constitution of People's Republic of China. So there will never be an alternate governing party in China. Zero chance. No, no, simply no. Okay. For whatever reason, no. You cannot have another governing political parties. While there are other political parties, but these other political parties has to work with the Chinese Communist Party. They cannot and never will rule China. This is a very strange concept to us. We have a political party. Every political party want to rule. But in China, yeah, you can have a political party, but you must agree you will never challenge the rule of Communist Party. Otherwise, you won't be able to allow to form.
What would their purpose be then if they couldn't do that?
They can represent a interest of a group of people. But a group of people doesn't mean you can rule the whole China. So you can have a political party representing, say, the steel factory workers. That's okay. And you have a political party representing, say, the Han people. That's okay. But no matter what political party, you cannot rule. Only the Communist Party can.
I suppose the only possibility would be a revolution.
Yes, and will be a very bloody one. Mm. Yeah, the only possibilities will be a very bloody revolution.
So in that, your whole picture there, you know, the Communist Party, the government, you belong to another party, you wouldn't be allowed to be part of the government. Is that what, not even as a representative or?
If you want to be part of the government, you need to be in the Communist Party of China.
Right. So any of these other parties can have no involvement.
Yeah, they will involve in a consultative sense rather than a proper political party sense.
If you're in one of those subordinate parties, would you or could you still be a member of the Communist Party?
Yes. Yes, you can. But again, the other political party is, may not allow you to become a member of the Communist Party because you are loyal to two different political parties, right? So there will be a contradiction.
So the way we understand political parties, it's not the same concept, is it?
Yeah, it's totally different concept. So although it's called
political subordinate parties, it's really interest group, as you see.
Yeah, it's more interest group or consultation groups rather than a view. So that is a very different situation compared with. Yes.
Okay. Now, but are they only like 1% of the government, those eight minor parties?
Sorry, again, the first part.
Only roughly 1%?
No, not necessarily. They're, some of them can be quite large. Can be quite large, but how large, I don't know. But mind you, the Chinese Communist Party is very, very large. The second largest political party in the world. We'll come to that a little bit later on.
Can you give an example of what one of those subordinate parties?
No, there's a democratic party in China as well. They promote democracy. And there's another, and that one meant to represent the people in Taiwan. But of course, they are very small compared with the mainland China because Taiwan has about, I think, 26 million people. So 26 million compared to 1.4 billion is.
What's the purpose of having them in the first place? Because they've got absolutely no power. They can't do anything, they can't change anything.
Consultation, I suppose. And they probably will have a seat in the National Congress.
Oh, okay.
In the top, but having one or two seats doesn't really change because we are talking about in the National Congress, about 3,000 members. So we will come to that a bit later on. Now, CCP or CPC or CCP, whatever you like to call it, is organized around the concept of democratic centralism. It is almost an oxymoron, okay? What do you mean by democratic centralism, okay? This is based on very much on the Marxist way of organizing the country. So we have to explain that one in order to really understand what is the Chinese political system. So let's move on, and then eventually I hope you will understand this. But in the CCP, the Communist Party, the top body is the National Congress, which convene every 5 years. So the daily operation of China has to be delegated to a top central committee. And therefore, when the National Congress is not in session, the Central Committee is the highest body. And this one meets about once a year. And then after that, then you have another different Politburo, okay, and its standing committees. This is where all the power concentrates. Okay, so theoretically, we have a 3,000 people's National Congress. Okay. That 3,000 National Congress will have subcommittees. And then all the subcommittees members will form a political bureau. And the political bureau will do the daily things about managing the whole country. So the power is very much concentrated at the top, national. So the next question is, of course, how these 3,000 people selected to form this National Congress? How they come about there? Because China is a very large country.
Well, it's Xi Jinping at the top of the political bureau,
both. Officially, Xi Jinping is the leader of three different committees. Okay, the political bureau itself, the general secretary of the Chinese Communist Party, which is just like our prime minister, is the head of the ruling, ruling party. Okay, and then the major power for Xi Jinping is being the head of the military commission of China. So basically he controls the armed forces, the military commission. He controls the politics because he is the secretary for the political bureau. And then he also controls the thinking because he is the general secretary of the Chinese Communist Party. So Xi Jinping grab a lot of power, but his predecessors also have all these powers. So it is not only to him.
So with his current situation where he can be there for life, effectively, it's in those three key positions.
Yeah, it's in that three key positions he can be. Now, he can be live because CCP's National Congress approved to remove the limitation of presidents and general secretaries to two terms. So removing that, that means you can be live. But whether that is true or not, we don't know yet. But Xi Jinping is now serving his second term. And it should be 2 years later, he will serve. If he's successful, will serve the third term. So I would suspect if he can serve the third term, he's very likely to serve the fourth term as well. But whether he can serve the fifth term, I have doubts. I think he won't, because he should be exhausted by then. Because being Xi Jinping is very hard work. He usually get up at around 5 in the morning and don't get to bed earlier than 11. It is a very tough job because there are so many meetings, and his meeting schedule had to be timed to minutes. Every minute counts, so a good job.
But would there be any difference at all between his role and a dictator in a different system?
Very large difference, because although he have all the power, but all the decisions are actually made by the committees. And all the committees actually make the decision and then pass it on him to almost just sign. But obviously, being head of these subcommittees, he will have a lot of input into the policy in the first, at the beginning. But just imagine you're managing 1.3, 1.4 billion people. Among the work there, you have to delegate to different subcommittees. So the subcommittees is the actual power, and they will have a lot of consultation from other levels as well. So in one way, people say, okay, the CPC National Congress look like rubber stamps. Very complicated legislature. The National Congress will pass it in 5 minutes, 10 minutes, almost like rubber stamp. But the fact is that the members in the National Congress are involved in all these subcommittees. They are working. So all this legislation is actually coming from them. They know what it is. So, well, we have discussed it for years, right? And before we propose it to the National Congress for approval, of course, everybody agreed, because anybody interested is already have put in their input into the final form before it's presented to the National Congress. Because National Congress assembling 3,000 people in Beijing, you just imagine the logistic. 3,000 people, you need 3,000 hotel rooms at least, plus all the people around these 3,000 people working for them. So every time when National Congress meets, we are talking about at least 20,000 people increase in Beijing around that little area. So, yeah.
So they make this year, didn't they?
Sorry?
They met this year.
They will meet every year.
No.
The National Congress?
Yes, didn't they meet this year?
No.
I think it's next year.
Next year.
I think it's next year or maybe year next. I can't remember. But anyway, let's move on. The party is an integral body organized under its program and constitution and on the basis of democratic centralization. Blah, 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 blah. So let's escape that. You can get it from my handout anyway. So let's move on. It has 8 principles. The CCP must, without exception, implement the principle of collective leadership. Again, what does it mean by collective leadership? And second, it implement the democratic centralization. Okay, what does it mean? Third, the basis of the subcommittees are all made public. That means transparent, okay? Don't argue about the transparency of the Chinese government. The Chinese government are transparent. It's a matter of whether you want to find it and read it. I can read their minutes. But again, minutes doesn't represent everything they discussed, but it's only represent the result of their discussion. And later on, that will become document policies. And the document policies is very much CCP needs, very much in very complicated terms, unless you know all other things, because they will say, talk about the 4 principles of da, 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 and then you don't know, oh, what are the 4 principles they're talking about? For example, the 4 principles of democratic relationship. What are they? But if you understand, we'll know that it means mutual respect, no interference of other people's domestic affair, data, and so forth. So you have to understand all these special terms they use very often. Yeah, that principle is not here. So because Mao is the first one who actually claimed on the power until his death. But after that, Deng Xiaoping implemented the 2 terms requirement. And now the 2 terms requirement is again removed. So whether Xi Jinping will have to rule until his death, or he will willing to give up after say, I think at least 20 years, my understanding, Xi Jinping will rule at least for 20 years. But whether he can extend beyond that, I don't know. I doubt that. But probably I won't know the answer by the time I don't know whether I'm alive or not. And all subcommittees will have deputies. So if a member for some reason cannot fulfill his jobs in the subcommittee, for whatever reason, then you don't need an election. Because the election itself will have a list, and the top number of people becomes the elected members. If any one of these elected members for some reason cannot fulfill his job, then the rest of the one will fill up. So election is not that common in a sense, but there is a lot of election in China. The election is mind-boggling. I will tell you more about that later on. And the 6th is a strict supervision mechanism, monitoring what happened. And should explore fixed terms, but it doesn't mean you must. And 8th is protect and expand the democratic rights. So there are the CCP declared policies. Again, all policies, declaration depends on interpretation. How do you interpret that? For example, the number 7, right? How do you interpret as not compulsory, it's a guiding principle. And that is where the arguments come in. Okay, multiple party cooperation. So they are united, what they call is united after under CCP. And they are the political consultative conference to gather all the ideas. So the party, the other political parties is more like a consultative interest group. Okay, here's the interesting part. The CCP, forget about the 2014. Look at the membership. It has 91 million members. 91 million members, okay? Yeah, a very large number of CCP members. So another unit is what they call the, this is the oath to enter the party. Well, anyway, it composed of different groups, fishermen, workers, there's a lot of grouping under there. And interestingly, about 35.9% are women. So don't talk about Chinese, it has no women in that leadership. Yes, they have. Quite a huge leadership is female. And these parties have committees in all levels, from a small village up to the top. There are many, many, many different subcommittees. These committees are elected by the party congresses at their own level. So, for example, UVA, Lunar Wedding UVA will have a Communist Party of UVA Lunar Wedding. Okay. Now this Communist Party is a subcommittee. It's an independent, a little committee. You have to be applied and then becomes a UVA Lunar Wedding members in order to be able to join this subcommittee, right? And you also had to be a Communist Party member in order to be in this committee. And this committee is elected by all the CCP or non-CCP members of UVA Lunar Wedding. So every one of us will provide votes to select this operating committee to govern us here. Now, there's a next level up, the UVA Victoria. We know we have many, many UVAs all around Victoria. So all these UVAs will vote for the committee for UVA Victoria. We, our ordinary member, doesn't get the right to vote. Only our committee member in UVA get to vote for the Victoria Committee, okay? And the Victoria Committee with the other committees in Australia will get to vote for UVA Australia. Another level up. Again, the members in our committee here, if you are not in the Victoria Committee, you doesn't get the vote. You vote through your representation in the next level up, and they vote for the representation next level up, and so it goes. Okay, so that is what they call centralized democracy. Democracy at the lowest level, and then from then onwards, then it's all centralized. You already wrote a committee, and let the committee represent you in the next level up. And then in the next level up, they represent you in the another level up. So there goes. And Yes.
Would the people, would everyone get to vote for something at some level?
People vote many under very different membership status. For example, I'm living in a little community. Say, Luna Wedding. Luna Wedding will have a CCP committee for Luna Wedding. So I will have a vote for there. But at the same time, I'm also a member of UVA Luna Wedding. So I have a vote in UVA Luna Wedding. Maybe I'm a teacher. So I'm a member of a teacher union. So I get to vote on for the teacher union as well. So people in China actually has a lot of votes in that sense by different memberships of different organizations. And when the organization has about 200 people, then there will be a CCP subcommittee in that organization, even if it is a private company. So for example, I have a private company. My company is growing larger and larger. I have now, say, 1,000 employees. Then by legal requirements, my employees can form their CCP subcommittees. And these CCP subcommittees, depending on how they want to form, for example, I want to form as a worker union. Then this subcommittee has asked for the permission of the next level up, a Victoria worker union, for a permission to form a subcommittee. Which is usually granted if you are large enough, then you will start operating. Yes?
Is it compulsory for everyone to vote?
No. It's not compulsory, okay? Now, give you an example. In 2020, during the peak of the pandemic, in Wuhan, they started to have that something called the square cabin hospitals. This hospital means they use a large venue like a sports stadium, and then partition into small cubicles, and then let all the people who should be quarantined, but they don't have symptoms, to live there. And these people, sometimes a large organization like that, we will have about 2,000 patients. And they may be there only for about, say, a week or two. When they are tested negative 3 times, they will be sent home. If their situation worsens, for example, if symptoms appear, then they will be sent to hospital. But while you are symptom-free and you are testing positive, you will stay in this square cabin. So the stay is not long. Yeah, talking about 1 week, 2 weeks. Some stay longer. Some have as long as almost 1 month. But they still have a CCP in each of these cabin hospitals, which operate only for about at most 1 month. So what are the services this CCP give to the patients? First of all, as a advocacy group of patients to negotiate with the way lives are held from the medical staffs. So they say, okay, we are bored. We need a television, right? And they say, okay, some of us want to have quiet times. So want to reduce your social dancing only to this amount of hours. Then I go say, no, we want to have social dance because we need exercise. So there's a committee, the committee will organize all this. But when everybody's gone, the committee is gone. So there are always something like that happening all around China. Subcommittees will be formed by Communist Party members. And then everybody, whether you are a Communist Party or not, got to vote if you have that a membership relationship. So among the 2,000 people there, not everybody is Communist Party members. There might be 100. Okay? These 100 will say, okay, we want to organize ourselves up as an advocacy group. we form a CCP subcommittee here. So everybody in the in that square cabin hospital will get a role, probably including the medical staff, but they will probably act as a liaison officer for that. Okay, so that is the political system in. Very unlikely, but yes, theoretically. Theoretically, yes. It depends on your ability, but the fact is very unlikely that you get promoted unless you become a member.
So there is discrimination.
Yeah, yes or no, because the, let's go back. Membership here, oh no. One more level up, I think. Membership. In 2014, there are 22 million applications. Only 2 million is accepted. So people actually fight to get into CCP. Now, Xi Jinping himself tried to get into CCP 6 times and failed. He got into it in the 7th time. But without getting into CCP, you are always just outside of that political force. You want to advance in your career, you better be a member of CCP. Because first of all, the committee members must be a membership of that group plus a committee of CCP. A member of CCP before you can form a CCP subcommittee. And then the next level up is voted by the CCP committee. And then the next level up is also voted by that CCP committee. And therefore, Communist Party members rule the non-members from the lowest level to the highest level, in a sense. Lowest.
What's the criteria for being accepted as a member?
Yeah, there is a criteria. And then after you are accepted, you have a Communist Party school for you to take courses in order to advance. Just like our company will have different professional training. So CCP also runs extensive professional trainings for its members.
Why did Xi Jinping have so much difficulty getting into the Communist Party in the first place?
Because he joined the Cultural Revolution. His father was disliked by Mao, and he was considered not a good candidate for CCP because of his parent. But after the Cultural Revolution, when his father regained the political position, he is accepted. So he has been rejected a number of times because of his father.
Criteria written down somewhere? Do you know what you have to do in order to be able to become a member?
Yes or no? You. We will get to that a little bit later on. Okay, so so let's look at is it. Okay, I have explained all this, so let I can move out of that. The Communist Youth League, okay? Here I have their anthem, but I don't think we need to play it now. You like, you can listen to the anthem, but let's move on to the discussion. It is also massive, okay? And to join, you have to be 14 and 20, between 14 and 28 when you join this youth league. It is organization structure is exactly duplicate of the main CCP structure. That means you are lower subcommittees and then higher subcommittees, et cetera, et cetera. So exact copy. And it has 89 million members as well. So let's add that two numbers together. Let's say here is 80 million, 90 million. And then for the CCP proper, another 80 million. So altogether, we have 170 million CCP members. 140 CCP members, either youth or the papa. And for the Chinese population is 1.4 billion. That means every 10 person, there's one CCP member on average. You see how CCP is all intertwined with the Chinese every day. Because think of it, 10 members. So here we have two CCP members here already. So whatever we do, the information will get collected. And CCP members, by definition, is loyal to CCP, because otherwise it will be kicked out. And therefore, all the information collected by this very local, low-level CCP members get fit into the subcommittee here. And the subcommittee will collect our problems or solutions and pass it onward to the next level, and there you go. Yes. No, not necessarily, but usually, but not necessary, because they have to apply independently. But once you are in the CY, in the league, it is very likely you can get into CCP. So it's not automatic, but a very high level. Okay, some notable members. Wu Jintao, the president before Xi Jinping. So he climbed to the top of the CCP leadership, and he was the first secretary in the 1984 to 1985 in the top CYL organization. So he has always been connected to CCP, right? The other one, the current premier, Lee Hak-keo. He is now still holding the premier position in China. So he is the second most powerful person in China after Xi Jinping. He is also a first secretary of the Youth League in 1993 to 1998. So in a way, the Youth League is a breeding ground for leaderships for the proper Communist Party. And of course, in a CCP kind of situation, there will be much more recreational, educational activities, because this is what youth organizations usually focus on. And through that, these people are trained or groomed to be the next generation. Now, with that information, let's consider Xi Jinping. Xi Jinping started as the village secretary in a very small town. And then 5 years later, move up to the county level. 5 years later on, move up to the provincial level. 5 years later on, move to another large province. 5 years later, moved to yet another large province, a large area, which is Shanghai. And then from Shanghai, he moved into the top political bureau. And then from there, he becomes the premier, the president. So how many years it took him?
25
years. And during that 25 years, he had built up experience in the lowest level to the high level. Now, Shanghai has about 20 something million people. It's like a small country already. So he has already managed populations as large as some countries. It's larger than Australia. Just being in Shanghai, managing Shanghai, he's managing more people than Australia. So you imagine the amount of experience necessary to get to there. And all the leaders since Mao all progress like this, including Xi Jinping and including everyone else before him, except Mao Zedong. Mao Zedong is different because he's a founding member. He's the one who is leading the army to, but once after that, when he dies, China moved into this system. And this system is a merit-based system because at the lowest level, unless you're doing something good, you won't be recognized by your peers in your level to move you up to the next level, right? So in that, when after you move up, you have 5 years to demonstrate that you can actually lead in yet another higher level before you can move up. And then when you move to province level, then it's different matter. Because at province level, the top will say, okay, I need you to go to there. So you almost like airdrop to another area and work there as head of that subcommittee. And then you may be airdrop. Now at that top level, yes, there are airdrops taking a person from here to there. But in the lower level, it's advancing like that. So by the time you're at the top level managing large provinces, then you are building up experience and building up connections. You build up connections. And then one of the reasons why Xi Jinping is so much emphasized on the poverty alleviations, because he was right down there in the village. He understands what is poverty. His dream was to let people have meat every week, very modest. And then he carried that motivation all the way up to being the president. And so people are proud of him, yes. Just like our city council, okay. Or and then next level is our state parliament. So in China, the province is more like our state parliament. But in the state parliament, then people all around in that parliament, in all these parliaments, we almost know each other. Just like we have the state cabinet. And the state cabinet obviously work with other state cabinets. They know each other. So there will be chances of airdropping someone from, for example, the vice premier from Victoria might be airdropped to New South Wales for a period of time in order to solve a problem. And then if you are successful, then obviously you will be airdropped to yet another larger province to solve a much harder problem, and you are successful, then you will move up to the brutal bureaus.
So I understand what you've been talking about largely relates to internal Chinese issues and domestic issues. How do they formulate their policies in relation to the rest of the world?
Good question. Obviously, nobody knows everything. So there is a lot of consultation groups, just like think tanks. Typically, all universities will have some kind of think tanks organizations in different departments. Social science departments might have a few think tanks. One about international politics, another one about domestic politics and so forth. And these people will be asked by that level's committee member. For example, our state parliament will ask the universities in Melbourne here, what are your suggestions to solve da-da-da problem? And then obviously that becomes a job requirement. And then they will send out to all interest party. Okay, you can bid for it. Get some money, do the study, give us a report by then. And then during that time, this university research team will work with the committee to understand, okay, what do you mean by asking us to do this? How much resource we have, da 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 da, and there will be a lot of communications, and then eventually they will write up a proposal. So there will be a number of proposals around from different organizations. And then that proposal will go up to our state parliament. The state parliament look at all these proposals, and maybe a number of them will involve in a number of different projects. But one overarching requirement, they are cooperative rather than competitive. That means if in this report we have a good idea, in that report we have a good idea, we take both ideas. Instead of I only take this report, reject everything from the other reports. They don't do that. They will pick from ideas from different reports and then pull together as a policy and then try to implement the policy. Deng Xiaoping say two things very important. The one is, no matter the cat is white or black, as long as it can catch mice, it is a good cat. All right, that's, and then the second thing he says, let somebody get rich first. These two ideas is translated into, we don't care who gives us the policy, as long as the policy works, that's a good policy. And the second one is, don't apply it to everybody first. Apply it to a small group. See whether it works or not. If it doesn't work, that policy is useless. Get somebody to get rich first. If they can't get it rich, no use. But if somebody get rich first, everybody will copy. In China, all these people get advanced to the next level by performance. You need to convince all your peers, yes, I'm good, right? So how do you do that? Copy each other. When they see your province doing something which works, thank you very much. I copy the policy over to my area. And then the policy spread through like that. So it's an organic spread through with competitions differently. When the policy doesn't work in this area, they have to readjust. Not much time, because if the people started to disagree with you, your rating get dropped, and then you will disappear from the political chain. For example, recently there was a province in China where there's a sudden outbreak of pandemics because they were not guarding the people coming into the province close enough. So some viruses leaked through. What happened? Their chief medical officer immediately taken off, sent home. Thank you very much. We don't need your service. You doesn't look after our people well. And that happens within 24 hours. Very, very quick. Now, yesterday, at around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, there was a collapse of a wall next to a hotel. And there is about 20 people trapped underneath the rubbles. At the moment, by about 6 o'clock in the afternoon, their time, the local time, 8 people were rescued out and 1 was dead. And then by about 10 o'clock in the evening, another 1 rescued out. And then the rescue is ongoing at the moment. They sent in 2 heavy equipped, two heavy equipment rescue team, 1 light equipment rescue team, 1 research rescue dog team, 1 engineering team, and 1 more team, I can't remember what. So that happened within half an hour. All these people are now working on the site. We see a huge crane there picking up heavy rubble in order to allow the. Yes. Because if you can't do that, then you are not standing by, you are out. Very, very responsive government at the moment. Whether they can remain that responsive for the rest, I don't know. But at the moment, they are very responsive. The current government is very, very efficient.
So to support all of this, you must have the equivalent of some sort of civil service.
Yes, the civil service are these members. The CCP members are also the civil service. So in order to get into civil service, first of all, you will have to go under an examination system. So it's not just interview. You have an examination system, handwritten examination system, okay? If you pass the handwritten examination system, then you will get the interview. And then you get into the civil service. But if you are not a member of the Communist Party, you have zero chance of moving upward. So if you get that job, usually you will apply to be a CCP members. And then once you apply to be a CCP members, you got the chance to be elected into your group's committee members. And then you got your chance to advancing. So yes and no. Theoretically, you don't have to be a CCP members to be a civil servant. But if you are not, then you almost have zero chance of promotion. You want to promote, you need to go through the CCP letters. And of course, going through the CCP letters also means you got a lot more support from the CCP itself. All the professional training, all the education about policy, education about political thinking, etc., etc. You are almost groomed to be the kind the Chinese government wants. So you are brain wash in a certain sense. But it depends on how you look at it. You can call it brainwashing, but you can also call it education. So again, this is the constitution. The constitution do change, okay? The Chinese constitution change quite often. It's much more frequent than you imagine. And in the 2018 change, the constitution included the Xi Jinping's ideas. Xi Jinping thought was written into the constitution, which is about the poverty alleviations. It is written into the constitution that the Chinese government will eliminate poverty and will become a moderate country by 2020, and then will become a strong country by 2049. So this year represents the first 100 years. That means it is the first 100 years of the establishment of CCP. And then in 2049 is the second 100 years, which represent the establishment of the People's Republic of China 100 years anniversary. So they have these two critical year. They written into the constitution and say, by 2021, China will become a moderately prosperous society. So Xi Jinping, no matter what he do, he had to get rid of extreme poverty by 2020. Because otherwise you can't call yourself a moderate prosperous country. And then the next goal is 2049. And that's why I think Xi Jinping will almost go there, will lead to there. But after that, probably Xi Jinping will too old to lead anymore. So probably a few years before 2049, he will retire and leave it to the next one. He has a hard job ahead, bringing China from a moderate prosperous society into an advanced society at that time. No extreme poverty. of course, they are poverty. So it depends on what you define as extreme poverty. That means people surviving at $1.90 per day per person. Yeah, if people is surviving at that level, it's called extreme poverty. CCP say it has eliminated all, but I would suspect there will be smaller pockets of that kind of poverty still exist. And then people are working on this last few, okay? So saying that it is absolute, I don't think so. There's no absolute in social science. But on a large scale, most of the people are now no longer homeless. There's no homeless people in China. Probably true, but it doesn't mean his house is windproof or rainproof. Okay, but they will have something. Okay, and again, I don't think there will be people starving. Food will be moderate. Okay, you can have your tummy feel full, but obviously not meat every time, every meal. The other interesting thing is, I think we talked about that in last lecture about the Chinese utopia. Our Chinese utopia is the widower, the poor, the disabled, etc. are being looked after. And again, I think Chinese has already accomplished that. But whether that is universal is still, again, depending on location. For example, there was a accident of a young boy having his arm chopped off. And then the aircraft leaving the area delayed to let this boy get onto the plane to go to the capital city of the Xinjiang province to have surgery to reconnect his hand. Now, that means in his country there, although there's an airport, but they doesn't have the medical ability to stitch them together. So there are still pockets like that, isn't it? We will expect, well, when you say advanced, your local hospital should be able to do it rather than send it to the capital city. Just like here, we might have a little urban towns, doesn't have very good medical facilities. Something happened, they may have to be ferried to our capital city to have the surgery. So these things still, there are still inequalities, but I think inequality is getting squeezed up so that the lower part is lifting up. Whether the upper part is skyrocketing, I think yes as well. But at least the whole society is being pulled up rather than the lower strata is still there and then the upper go through the roof. They are trying to drag the whole country up. That's their policy.
Albert, why do you think the Chinese government seems to be upsetting so many countries these days, Southeast Asia, North America, Europe? Is it deliberate?
I think you've got a wrong understanding of the support. At the moment, in terms of say, what's they called? In the proposal in the United Nations, for example. Then, for example, about the Xinjiang problem, okay. We know there are countries saying
You are at home, eh?
Yeah?
Can I call you back? Can I call you back? Because that.
Okay. But for example, in Xinjiang problems, there are about 30 countries support the Canadian statements that China is violating human rights. Okay. But okay. China also get 90 countries to support that. No, there's no human rights problem. So whether the issue here is what our news is telling us is only a small fraction of the news available in the world. We are bombarded by English news. We didn't get the chance to read the non-English news, like in Al Jazeera, like in Russia, like in China. So we don't know. In fact, you remember in the meeting in Anchorage, the Chinese delegate tell no, you only can represent yourself. You doesn't represent international ideas. What you call rule-based order, international order. China think, yes, we should follow rule-based international order, but which set of rules? You say your American rule or the United Nations rule. China said, no, we follow the United Nations rule, not your American rule.
And that handout you gave us from that Anchorage conference showed that the reporting and the type of questions asked were very skewed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The reporting is very, very skewed. So that is something I want to ask you to read broader news. Mm-hmm. Don't limit yourself only to the American-centric or British-centric views. They are the views from American and from the British point of view, but there are other views as well. The African views are the largest growth economy, I think, will be coming from the Asian countries, Indonesia, Philippines, etc., Singapore. The Asian countries will be a driving economic engine in the next 10 years or so. And then after that, I think the driving engine will move to Africa. Africa is now gearing up. They are having a lot of infrastructure built, and therefore their economy is going to grow, but not in the next five years, but starting about 10 years, I think we will see Africa's economy growing. Whereas the European economy and the American economy will remain approximately the same with a little bit of growth, like 2-3% per year. But we will be looking at the Asian countries growing at 6-8%. African countries growing at 6-8% about 10 years later, and even jump up to 10% in both of these regions. That's my long-term view. The world will become a multipolar world rather than the single polar world today. That's what I hope at least. Okay, a little bit over time. And obviously I haven't finished yet. So we will get to that next time.
And sometime, could you please explain to us how in China they raise taxes and how the money works?
Okay, the financial aspect. Yeah, okay, I will do that later on. Yeah, thank you.